I guess the proper way of saying it is good day. Because here it's afternoon, and some places might be watching. It'd be morning or evening or whatever. And if it's rebroadcast, or you know, you go on the internet and look it up, it could be any time today. So good day. I pray that you're having a good day. We are here. Amen. If you're having a tough day, keep your eyes upon Christ.
Amen.
He has promised, and we will go through this here now. His promise, if we keep our eyes upon Him, we cannot fail.
Amen.
But it's up to us. Let's kneel for prayer. Our Father in heaven, we thank you for the privilege of coming and recognizing who you claim to be. Help us to understand who you are. Help us to understand what you want us to be. Because you've given us a claim that we can represent you. Oh Father, this is so difficult at times in this world. It's always been difficult. I pray that you will be with each one of us and help us each, Father, to deny self, to accept your dear gift that you freely gave to us at cost of his sacrifice of his life of your dear Son. We thank you, Father, for this privilege and this opportunity. In your dear Son's name, amen.
Amen.
This church has gone through many ups and downs, many challenges. Many different things. I'm not finding the notes I'm even wanting to start with. Does that sound good? So I'll just have to go from memory for a couple seconds. We've heard things, been taught things, and been told that it's a sin to strive. That was popular a few years ago.
Right.
If we strive and put effort, Christ has done it all, so why should we strive? We've been taught that you must strive. You got to be perfect. We've been taught, you know, for a while our church went through the law of Galatians. It was, you know, presented in such a way as dry as the hills of Kaboa. I mean, just about anything in any rut that you can think of, a lot of us has been exposed to. I remember some evangelists back in the late 60s and early 70s. Now, this is a Seventh-day Adventist evangelist. This isn't some evangelical or far-off thing. If I make it to heaven, if you didn't have the security, if I make it to heaven, it'll be by the skin of my teeth.
Oh, I've
heard that. Has anybody heard that before?
Oh, yes.
Do you realize why people are confused? When you go to God's church, you hear all these different things. And the visitor, which some here are familiar with, it's the union paper of this area, which is the Mid-Atlantic. In January of 1995, they're advertising a new book that they came out with. I think this book says a lot. Martin Weber, my wife actually went to school with him at CUC for 1 year. She knew him. And he was the one that wrote this book. Who's got, I thought I wrote it down here. Who's got the truth? And he was giving his testimony in this book, in this advertisement, actually. I never got the book. That someone who gave him a series of takes on Righteous by Faith by Graham Maxwell. Mm-hmm. Now, Alter Maxwell was mentioned yesterday. This is one of his sons. He says, that's good. Then he got some books by a guy named Morris Vinden. Has anybody ever heard that name? He said he had some good points, but he didn't agree with Maxwell. Well, if he had some good points, it wasn't very many good points, I'll guarantee you that, because I think we know his theology. Then he read an article by George Knight. Some of us are familiar with that name. He's supposed to be a good church historian about Righteous by Faith. Then he read and got some good points. But all these disagreed with one another. Then he got a book by Dr. Ralph Larson. There was other contradictory things. Then he got another book by Jack Sequeira. What am I supposed to believe? Now what he did, another book, and I just remember this. He went through each of these and said they each had good points, but where he disagreed with every one of them and brought out what he believed. Now, does that sound like potluck theology? Do you wonder why the people are confused? These were all trained in our institutions. I had from the questionnaire, do you see why yesterday, and I'm going to go over it again, we need to look to Christ ourselves. Satan gets us, and many times we trust the pastor so much, we will trust him over the plainest scripture and the plainest spirit prophecy. And I'll tell you, Ellen White makes it as plain as can be. But yet, he's been taught systematic theology. Systematic theology is philosophy. And there's only one true source of philosophy, and that's from God and from the Bible. If we take man's philosophy, and I remember just a couple years ago, my wife and I watched 3ABN from time to time when we're eating or when we're doing something. We aren't. There was a minister that didn't like ministering, so poor guy. He said to somebody, he says, I'm going to go to the seminary. The cemetery? And he says, well, I don't know what to do. It's several months before it gets started. He says, well, theology, why don't you go to the local college here and take a course in philosophy? They go hand in hand. I think I'll do that. I never heard that before. That was probably only 10, 15 years ago. I'm glad I didn't get mixed up in that mess. I probably wouldn't be here today. Now, I had one request to explain what happened and what was taught at 1888. I cannot do that in 20 hours. And I have only been given an hour's time. And I'm not really an authority on that. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to give you some resource materials. Some of these, some don't like, because it has this much error in it. And it's not related really to 1888. The first book, one of the first books I got on it, this book here is about 30 years old. We got it in about 85. The 18:8 message and introduction. You can get this on Amazon cheap. But I would recommend really this book. It's been updated and revised. Same author, same book. Robert Willand, 1888 message and introduction. It tells you the theology of righteous by faith, what was taught during that time. I will say here, I do not agree with everything Robert Whelan believes and his ministry stands for. So don't go to their website and get every book they publish and say Jack Barney endorsed it. But I do recommend this book or this book 99%. Because there's a little bit of Godhead put in there, just a very little bit. In fact, this one here, it can be interpreted either way. This one here, they added another statement to make it more clear in their favor. So that's two books. Robert Whelan, 1950, opposed what was being taught at 1888 that was rejected. And he did a dissertation and had a whole ministry built around it. I went to their one of their presentations once at Andrews in 87. And that was 1987 was just before 100th anniversary of 1888. And he was foreseeing that there would be a bunch of books being published on the false view of 1888. And there was. Now, at that time, I think the Ellen White Estate was trying to do their best. And I talked to Robert Olson about that time, or shortly thereafter, and had a wonderful interview with him, and I knew some of the other people on the White Estate. And they were wanting to get the truth out. And that's why they quickly put out these books in a rough form. And you know, if you have any of these books, some of it is very difficult to read. But they didn't have time because they lingered too long. But there's four volumes of that. Many of you are familiar with them. There's nothing really super special about them. They are on the CD-ROM that I would recommend everybody get, or if you want to go to the internet, but I don't have good internet, and you know, the CD-ROM's better. But all that's on there, plus everything else, and a lot more information. If you want to know what happened after the General Conference in 1893, how many is familiar with this book? I see three hands, four hands. My wife could raise both hands because we've got a couple copies. This book, not only I recommend, but I'm going to read you what Ellen White has to say about it. I have been instructed. Now, who instructs Ellen White? Lord. Some will tell you James White did. I haven't come across that statement yet, but she says, I have been instructed to those discourses of yours printed in the General Conference bulletins of 1893 and 1897, which contain strong arguments regarding the validity of the testimonies and which substantiate the gift of prophecy among us. I was shown that many would be helped by these articles, and especially those newly come into the faith, who have not been made acquainted with our history as a people. It will be a blessing to you to read again these arguments, which were of the Holy Spirit's framing. So if you want to know, because it is so interesting. I mean, it is almost like being at the General Conference. if you can imagine. I know the young generation can't do that because if they can't see it, they can't listen or read something and visualize it. But Jones would ask a question and the audience would respond and he'd go back. I mean, it's just almost like being there and be a part of them. What happened in 1888 that the loud cry would come from the audience? What has happened that we didn't get the ladder rain? They thought it was going to come at any time. Hundred and almost 50 years later, we don't even anticipate that. I would recommend this very highly. That's available that's all available if you go to if you put Wieland in 1888, those books will come right up, and you can get them. I got that new one for $1. I think it's what, $4 or $5 counting freight. But if you have any problems or anything, is available from Glad Tidings Publishers, Berrien Springs, Michigan. Now, there's also a couple articles, and please write this down. If you're not exposed to these, that I would recommend. The book, Thoughts from the Mount of Blessings. The Sanctified Life. Christ Object Lessons. Steps to Christ. Those are all primarily dealing with righteous by faith and different things. Would you go out and get a leaf off of that tree? I forgot it. There's a walnut tree right out there, and I want that. There's a big one out there. I'm going to give you an illustration from nature. Bring me a nice big leaf. Let me finish this this questionnaire. Why has Christ not come? I've asked one to be quiet because I'm getting ready to read that reference. Why has Christ not come? What did you put on your form, or what do you think? Why has it been delayed? Ellen White thought it was going to come in her day.
When the character of Christ is fully reproduced in his people, then he'll come.
I told someone else not to quote that one.
He doesn't have a group of people to reflect his character.
You said in your own words the same thing. You said in your own words.
Those quotes are good if you're talking about unity, like what you were talking about last time.
I'm going to read that clearly in the next paragraph. I don't want to come across judgmental here. But a lot of the responses was typical.
Want that?
No, I don't need that. A lot of the responses was typical. We are not ready. God's people are not ready. Now, is we you?
Yeah.
And not me?
Well, we might be included or we might not be.
That's right. Daniel prayed a prayer of confession for his people and included himself. But we can be a little bit pharisaical and think we're above and include the we because I am a part of them. You understand what I'm saying? We need to make sure that we understand our need and our true relationship. Now, what I want to do with this simple leaf, Ellen White calls it a simple leaf. Some of you know where I'm going with this because I sent a little email out about it, but that's okay. Ellen White calls us a simple leaf. God makes the simple leaf, the tiny flower, the blade of grass, with as much care as he creates a world. This simple leaf. Now when you get out of here, I want you to go out and look how many simple leaves there are. Just here. The symmetrical structure of a strong, beautiful character is built up by individual acts of duty. All should learn to be faithful in the least simple things, as well in the greatest duty. Their work cannot bear the inspection of God unless it is found to include faithful, diligent, economical care for the little things. In our society, we think the big things is important and little things can be neglected. We just read a thing yesterday where there were 6.5 million Adventists in 1985, if I remember right. And now we're around 20 million and dipping people, you know, faster than we've ever done. And we are looking for, it was so interesting a number of years ago, I was talking about, should we have an organization? Somebody was trying to get me to present a thing and do a thing on, it's not God's will for our church to be organized. And read the letters, we only got a membership of 70 some thousand. What are we going to do when we have 144,000? Now let me tell you about this simple leaf. Now, on the underside of this leaf, it has little openings, like a little tiny mouth. Stomata is right. That little opening on the lower part of the leaf that allows water, oxygen, carbon dioxide to pass into and out of the plant. That's only part of an answer. If you go out here and strip that tree of every leaf, it will die. I always thought the roots and the moisture in the roots and things is what, made the tree grow. That moisture has to get up to this leaf, and the leaf provides the food for the tree to cause it to grow. That little simple leaf. And if I, in heaven, I won't need equipment, but if I look the edge of that by tearing apart and looking the edge of that, it looks like a computer chip with a bunch of layers and a bunch of things going inside. A tomato leaf, I'd have you guess and have multiple choice and we'd have fun here for a while. A tomato leaf has 84,000 stomatas, openings, little mouths, per square inch. That's smaller than what this is. And why do I want a walnut leaf? An oak has 290,000 per square inch. We can't even see one without a powerful microscope. 290,000 openings in that simple leaf. Is God interested in the simple things in our life? Are we just a number to God? Absolutely not. He would send his dear beloved son just for one person. And we need to remember that. At the end of time, every earthly support will be cut off. We need to learn to lean on his dear son. I'm going to go back to that Christ object lesson. Quote, Christ is waiting with a longing desire for the manifestation of himself in his church when the character of Christ is what?
Perfectly.
And perfect, Ellen White met, or I should say God met, perfect. Reproduced in his people, then he will come. He needs to have a people that he can work with. He's not going to send people out that aren't representing him. He's done it in the past. Christ sent the disciples out and they weren't able to witness or do anything. He took the children of Israel out of Egypt. Where did they want to go for 40 years? They wanted to go back to Egypt. They preferred slavery than what God was trying to do for them. They were happy where they were before than where they were at the time. With the pillar of fire by night and the cloud by day. How foolish they were. How foolish we are. It is a privilege of how many Christians? Every Christian, the next paragraph, is a due privilege of every Christian not only look for, but to hasten the coming of the Lord. We're all who profess his name, bearing fruits to his glory, how quickly the whole world would be sown with the seed of the gospel. Quickly, the last great harvest would be ripened and Christ would come to gather his precious people. That was written in 1900. Now, a lot of you know these texts. I'm just going to fly through them because of time. I was asked a couple things about the 144,000. It's an interesting study. We could go through. I tell you what, the most important things, it's in Revelation 7, first part, and Revelation 14, first part. The most important question or thing is, Ellen White says we should strive to be among this company. The second thing is we need to have the characteristics that are outlined in Revelation 14. They will have their Father's name in their forehead. And that means having the Father's character. Now we're talking 144,000. We aren't talking 20 million. For they are without fault before the throne of God, and they have no guile in their mouth. That means no false theology. No deception. Without fault means character perfection. There's a lot of theories on the 144,000. I'm not going to go into it at all. We aren't even sure if Ellen White is included in that number. She says she will be among that number. There's a difference. I can read that both ways. Yes. Don't speculate. If we aren't told, don't speculate. There are some who believe that the 144,000 is all the pioneers that spoke the three angels' message. Now, I want to tell you, if you thought 144,000 that would live, they think that they're going to come up in a special resurrection and be among the 144,000 to see Jesus come. That's a little bit hard to convince that they'll be translated without seeing death to include that, but I'm not convinced of that argument. But some propose that that's a possibility. Some teach that there, 144,000 has got not very many percentage when you're talking, don't discourage the people. Hey, there are 144,000 evangelists preaching the truth without deceit in her mouth. Don't make the road too broad. We're told there'll be 144,000 living to see Jesus come. They're a special company, and we should strive to be with that group. That's all I'm going to say. And if we are 80 years old or older, we're still to strive to be among that group, because they're a special group. If any man be in Christ, he is a... God is not a patchwork. He does not fix our garment. He puts his robe on us. When he shall appear, we shall become like him. Yeah, you answered it right. He laughed at that. We will be like him. Every man that hath this hope in him purifieth himself even as he is pure. Colossians chapter 1. Christ in you, the hope of glory. My wife will tell you, she was sitting at a church, in a certain church, at a certain time, and she hit this in the Holy Spirit. Christ in you, the hope of glory. This turned the light on for her. It changed our life. When we preach, warning every man, teaching every man in all wisdom, that we may present every man perfect in Christ Jesus. That is verse 28 of Colossians 1. I did a study recently about the Bible being complicated. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, I just missed the clarification. You said some people believe that the 144,000, well, that the pioneers who died in carrying this message.
There's people that believe that, yes. Yes.
There is a special resurrection, though.
There's a special resurrection for a group of people that have died in the third angel's message. Whether they're a part of the 144,000 number or not, we aren't told. I personally don't believe they are.
I don't think they are either.
Well,
I just wanted to clarify.
Okay. But, we could... We could discuss this pros and cons. There's a lot of, I like to do some math and figure, I figured out one time how long it would take for Jesus to put a crown on everybody's head. It only took 1 second. It would take, I think it was a couple months I came up with. But it's going to take us a week to go to heaven. And Jesus is going to give us a crown on our head individually. That has to be omnipresence. Or stopping time or something. But there's a lot of interesting things on that, and thank you for having me clarify that. And as I was stating, many times in history, God has used what he had. He used the disciples, and they went out, and they couldn't work miracles, and they couldn't instruct and things. Lord, teach us how to teach. The Israelites, when they went into Canaan, almost immediately, they mixed in with the heathen. Soon as we've read here a couple times, soon as Joshua died and the generation that worked with him, then they went. They really weren't prepared. It's not going to be that way this time, brothers.
Amen.
We're not going to make it to heaven by the skin of our teeth and by being a little bit above somebody else's special group. And somebody, and just making it by a little bit, or by losing a little bit. God is looking for a special people. The power of Satan is 100 times more, now more powerful, than now was 1873. 100 times more powerful now than it was when he was in heaven deceiving the angels. And he got a third of the angels. He had a half. But he ended up with a third. Men and women today are deceived, blinded by his insinuations and devices, and know it not. Ellen White is not addressing this to the non-Christian. So he's addressing that to God's professed people. The adversary of souls is in these days with greater power than ever before. 1874. He's 10 times more powerful than the times of the apostles. Now, a few of us have some gray hair here. Now, think back a few years back. I'm going to ask you a question. Do you think Satan is more deceptive and more powerful and more accepted today than he was a generation or two ago?
Sure.
Or when you first remember being baptized or whatever. Is he more deceptive?
Sure.
Would you say one or two times more?
No.
Is he more deceptive after TV and all the technology came out? I don't know why he didn't know what a radio was. She was better off. How many times greater now? God knows how Satan is working. And he sends his angels to watch over his children to protect them from the devil's power. And the battle is constantly going on. Sometimes, and the truth about angels that I recommended you read, there is sometimes a physical combat between the angels. That would be interesting, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
See, supernatural beings fighting over us poor mortals, weaklings. And God would send every angel if necessary. And one angel can send back a legion of demons, evil angels. What's a legion?
10,000.
1,000. That's pretty powerful, I would say. While the power of the human race to resist temptation is continually increasing, are we increasing our resistance to the devil?
No.
No, we're decreasing. The power of the human race to resist temptation is continually decreasing. Satan's skill and power to tempt is continually increasing. Signs of Times, September 29, 1887. Doesn't sound very possible that we can do from some of these statements. We need to learn to have clear perception, discernment, to know how to discern Satan's temptation. We can only do that, as we've gone over many times, by the sword, by the word of God. We need to... His attacks will grow fiercer and more frequent as we near the end of time. I'm going to give you some hope before we get over. And but what I want to go through is a little bit of the way people think. Now, this goes back, I understand, to Christ's time, and it was probably back to the Jewish philosophy of the judgment. They believe that, you know, in the judgment is going to be a balance. And this is what the Pharisees and people taught at Jesus' time. If my good works outweigh my bad works, I'll make it. If I'm a little bit above the average people, I'm safe. This is what they taught. We believe the same thing today. Not we, but we as a people. But some are saying, well, I'm not good enough to be saved, and I'm too good to be lost, so I don't know what's going to happen. I don't know which way it's going to teeter. If you don't know which way it's going to teeter and you don't have Christ, it's not a guessing game for me. Does God have a New Testament temple? I think I heard a no, and I think I heard a yes.
Yes.
Does he have a New Testament temple?
Yes.
Is it in Jerusalem?
No.
There might be some there now. Don't be judgmental. Is there any in the United States?
Yes.
There is? Where is it at?
Here. Right
here. Smyrna? Is this God's temple? God's temple is our bodies. There is a New Testament temple, brothers and sisters. When Christ was here, he said, "You've taken my Father's house and made a den of thieves, and it's your house." So our body is a temple, is to be the temple of the Holy Spirit, and it is up to us to decide if it is. I wish I had power over time sometimes, but I don't. The law requires us to present to God a holy character. It demands of men today just what it demands of Adam and Eve: perfect obedience, perfect harmony with all its precepts and all relations of life under all circumstances. We aren't going to be judged by the good days we had, or only by the good days. We are going to be judged by all circumstances and condition. Sometimes we go through a pretty trying time. There's a song about the God of the mountain is the God of the valley. Have you ever heard that song? It's the same God. God's not going to just judge us when we're having a good experience and things going good. I'm going to give you an experience. We have all gone through a trial. I've had 100 people in my house, approximately 100 people in my house, two different times. I know what it is to organize a thing like this. It's a lot of pressure. It's a lot of responsibility. And I know when it seems like each year something comes up and Alan has things. He's got tremendous pressure now. So just think of when somebody's going through a trial and when you're going through a trial. But God, you know, sometimes my wife says when we're going through a trying experience with different things, "I thought we weren't supposed to be tried above what we're able." It's easy to lose our hold on God at times. It's easy to give up. It's easy to not act like a Christian. But just think of what Christ did for us. He had much more severe because he was a perfect character. The whole weight of the world, in fact, if he had have fallen, I don't know what it would have done to the universe. I don't know. I've talked about it and thought about it. But God's government would have been at risk in heaven. Can you imagine the weight of responsibility on the Son of God? And what he went through for us without eating for 40 days, and then at the end of his life, his most critical test, his most severe test, without eating any more than he ate at the Passover. He stayed up all night, was on trial unjustly. You talk about pressure. He had the weight of the universe upon him. Is there hope? Is victory possible? It's not only possible, brothers and sisters, it is promised. Paul says in Romans 8 that we are to be what? More than conquerors. Can I be more than conqueror on my own strength?
No.
Can I fight any of devils, angels. He's a supernatural being. We are to be more, when we're connected with Christ, we are more than conquerors. I'm going to review a little bit what I taught yesterday. And I don't have enough time to go through all this list. If you want more complete than what I've shared with you, just send me an email requesting it. And I would be happy to share it with you. We need to be humble and teachable. I'm not going to read all the references. I read them yesterday. And you can look them up. If you go to CD-ROM and look up humble and teachable, you will get hundreds. God will not work with somebody that is not humble or teachable. First Peter 5:5. Likewise, ye younger, submit yourselves to the elders, yea, all that are be subject to one another, and be clothed with humility, for God resisteth the proud and giveth grace to the humble. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time. And James 4:6 even makes it shorter than that. Matthew 5:3. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Now, blessed means happy are they, poor in spirit. What's it mean to be poor in spirit? I'll be honest with you. It had been a while since I read that. I had to look it up. What's it mean to be poor in spirit? Does that mean going through a depression? What does it mean? Realizing our spiritual need, our spiritual condition. If we don't realize our spiritual condition, we're no better than the Pharisees of Jesus' time. Many take the sayings of others for truth, being too indolent, to put themselves to diligent, earnest labor, represented in the word as digging for hidden treasure. Man's inventions, did I mention man's inventions of how of get righteous by faith here earlier? Man's inventions are not only unreliable, they are dangerous, for they place man where God should be. A new babe in Christ, you got to do what the pastor tells you for a while. But when you start understanding Christianity and understanding our beliefs, it's time to get your eyes off of that guy and get on to studying for yourself. Some people go no higher than their Sabbath school teacher. Some people go no higher than their pastor. The grace of humility should be cherished by everyone who names the name of Christ, for self-exaltation can find no place in the work of God. Those who would cooperate with the Lord of hosts must daily crucify self. True humility must be seen in all they do. The Lord rejoiced that the plan of salvation was so plain that a child in its simplicity could understand it, while those who not spiritual and humble and willing to learn were puffed up in their own self-conceit could not see the beauty of the gospel because it is spiritually discerned. But all who are honest, teachable, childlike, who desire the truth will see the power of God when it's revealed. Human theories and philosophies will never lead to an understanding of God's Word. What did I say a while ago about philosophy? And theology mixed? Those who suppose that they understand philosophy think that their explanations are necessary to unlock the treasures of knowledge and to prevent heresy from coming into the church. Now, I witnessed that powerfully in February when I went to that thing on the Trinity and how to present the Trinity. I shared a little bit of that with you yesterday. To these explanations that they have brought in false theories and heresies. This was written in 1900. I think she's talking about what's happening today. In fact, I know people have said that she didn't write for her time, she wrote for us. But she saw this happening in her day. The scriptures are not to be adapted to meet the prejudice and jealousy of men. They can be understood only by those who are humbly seeking. There's another reference here about even teachers are not good teachers unless they are a student. Our problem is we do not realize our spiritual condition. I'm going to read a part of a quote here. I'm not going to read the whole thing. I hate to say this is the only reference. There's only one hit, if you know what I mean, in all the spirit of prophecy. The only safe position for any of us to take. Now, if she has an only statement, how many possibilities are there? Yeah, and there's only one reference, too. The only safe position for any of us to take is to consider ourselves sinners, daily needing in divine grace. That's our only safe position. If we means we, you, that's not a safe position for me. Am I making that clear enough? Mercy through the atoning blood of Christ is our only plea. Let us shun Phariseeism. Have I mentioned Phariseeism here before? A couple of times. I have a whole collection under Phariseeism. I'm not going to read them. Look them up for yourself. I don't have time to read them. Shun Phariseeism. They were so proud that they were so good. Like the guy got an award for being humble and wore his badge all the time. There's another tactic of Satan. Is getting us in his way of deception to think that we're standing under the banner of Christ and his righteousness when we have changed so much that we are standing and supporting his hellish banner. We're changed leaders and did not even know it. We need to keep our eyes fixed on Jesus Christ. Paul says daily, and some we were discussing this a little bit earlier. I says, no, not daily, not hourly, every moment. My wife knows what button to push for me to get upset. I know a few of hers, and we try to avoid them. Uh-oh, I just confessed that I'm not there yet, right? I want to tell you something. The devil knows me better than my wife does. The devil knows me better than I do. Because I inherited things according to the third commandment. that I don't even know about, but the devil does. He knows my weakness more than I do. Oh, I am going to read one. Today, there are thousands and tens of thousands who are making the same mistake. And this is a reference dealing with Phariseeism. That's another only reference, by the way. We need a vital connection with Christ. Now, what's vital mean?
Living.
It means living. It means a real. It's very difficult to graft into a tree. You've got to practice and practice and practice. But once you're grafted into the vine and it is healed and it's a good graft, you're part of that vine. That's what we need to do. There's other similar connections that it's brought out explanations. We need to be co-workers with Christ. When we attach ourselves to His yoke, we are co-workers with Him. We're abiding with Him. That's one of my favorite words. Abide with me. We're grafted. We're in Christ. Partakers of the divine nature. I have a lot of quotes here, and my time is about up, about being partakers of the divine nature.
Amen.
Now, don't take that we start becoming divine. We don't. But we need to partake of the divine nature. There are four quotes that I've read before, myself, not here. And I'll tell you the truth, I didn't remember reading them before, and I've read the fourth volume of Testimonies before, together. I'm going to give you four quotes, and to save time, I'm going to give you the references for these same quotes. They are out of the fourth volume of Testimonies at the end. Man, although the most helpless of God's creatures, when he comes in the world, and the most perverse in his nature, is nevertheless capable of constant advancement. He may be enlightened by science, ennobled by virtue, and may progress in mental and moral dignity until he reaches a perfection of intelligence and purity of character, but a little lower than the perfection and purity of the angels. That's not after the second coming. In the same book, the same love that animates the angels, the same purity, same holiness. We must look in the mirror of God's love and discern the defects in his moral character and put away his sins, washing his robe. Oh, that, I thought that was works. That's what we're being taught. I don't have time to go there, and I know you know better than that. If you don't, contact somebody that does, or contact me and I'll direct you. I'm not going to tell you, I'll direct you. The religion of Christ refines and dignifies its possessor. Whatever his applications or station in life may be, men who become enlightened Christians rise above the level of their former character to greater mental and moral strength. Those fallen and degraded by sin and crime may, through the merits of the Savior, be exalted to a position but little lower than the angels. The redeemed will be above the angels in heaven because we have an experience nobody in the universe. While now, in performing his duties on earth, he designs that we should rise higher and higher toward the state of perfection, seeing and realizing at every step the power and glory of God. previous to that, I did not read, but a little less than level of the angels. Okay, that's testimonies, page 93, 267, 294, and 415. Same book. That's how she used that phrase four different ways. I did a search, and I'm not even going to read them. I don't have time. Changed into his likeness. It actually was into his likeness, but it was referenced to into his likeness. I got 131 hits. My most favorite quote or thing in Desire of Ages. There's a section around Desire of Ages, 480, talking about Jesus, the Good Shepherd. He goes before us and makes a pathway for us. His feet presses down the cruel thorns. You read 480 and I think 483. There's a picture in there, so it doesn't have three pages. But read 480 and beyond. Read the whole chapter. Study the whole book. I love these either-or statements. I'm going to read one now. Your hope is not in yourself, it is in Christ. Your weakness is united to His strength. Your ignorance to His wisdom. If you think you're smart, you don't know anything, Paul says, as you ought to know it. You're a Pharisee is what you are. Your frailty is His enduring might. We need to depend wholly upon Him. We are to bear His divine image. Okay, I'm going to give you another reading assignment. Now, this isn't for you old folks. Okay, this is for the new ones. Okay, if you've been in this for generation, the exercise of the will, study that very carefully. It's in fifth volume of Testimonies, 513, Ministry of Healing, 176. It's also in Messages to Young People, 151. I'm not going to go through it, but we have to choose. If we don't think something or want to do something, we aren't going to accomplish it. If we don't have a strong will to do something, we do, and we have time for what we want to do, for the most part. Sometimes we want to do more than we should do. God never assigns us to do more than we should do. Just remember that. If we're working too much, we're doing more than God asks us to do. Now, he will send us little trials here and there, and sometimes we have to work a little extra. But if we're regularly overexerting ourselves and spending too much time on our work and not enough time with our family and with God, we are violating God's command. It is for you to yield up your will to the will of Jesus Christ. And as you do this, God will immediately take possession and work in you.
Amen.
I need to bring up a little thing here for the new ones and refresher for the older ones. New and old is time in Christ, okay? After you're born again, after you're converted. Some take what I just read and teach that when you are truly converted, you are perfect. Jesus will remind you every time before you sin. That's called, my brothers and sisters, instant sanctification. That is a false teaching. We may stumble and fall many times. The first book of Ton also introduces some concepts here about sinning. And when we're united with God, we cannot sin. That led out in the Holy Flesh movement. There were terrible things going on. That is a false theology. But we are to be perfect in Christ, and He will bring us up. I promised a couple that I was going to talk about many like Peter. We need to study the life of Peter. How long did it take for Peter to start sinking in the water? How long did he take his eyes off of Christ? Just for a moment. I mean, he was looking at Christ. Hey, look what I'm doing. Where was he? Halfway down the water. Peter couldn't swim. Lord, save me. We need to study. In Christ's object lesson here, I'm going to give you an assignment. Peter's fall. Page 154, 155, about Peter's fall. His fall of denying his Lord just didn't happen just like that. The devil was preparing him for a long time for that. Lord, I won't deny you. And he proved it by cutting off the priest's servant's ear. You know what Jesus did? He put that ear back on to his enemy. Peter's fall was not instantaneous, but gradual. Self-confidence led him to that fall. No one who claims holiness is really holy. When persons claim that they are sanctified, which means holy, they give sufficient evidence that they are far from being holy. That is very similar to believing in Phariseeism. What do you answer somebody when you share this truth? What's their first question they ask you? Are you holy? That's right. How should we answer them? Should we dance around? No. We answer them, Christ is my Savior. He's my righteousness. And my righteousness is its filthy rags. Isaiah 64. Our righteousness is filthy rags. We need to control our thoughts. We will be guilty before God as if our thoughts were carried out in the action. If we think about doing something, we are going to be judged by our thoughts. We don't have to physically do anything. If I desired to rob a bank and wanted to do it, the books of heaven record the sins that would have been committed if we had opportunity. That means when nobody's watching, I can take something off the shelf or something that there might be 1,000 things there, but you never miss. Well, I don't do it, but I would really like to. We need to understand our natures and our weak points. And we need to take, we're promised that our weak points can become our strong points. We need to come to a place that we'd rather die than sin. That's what the 144,000 has to be. We'd rather die than perform a wrong act. There's an issue among some in Adventism today on the taking on the divine nature. What nature did Jesus have when he was on this earth?
Divine nature. Human nature.
Divine. Now, I just read a book, and I do not recommend reading this book. I read a lot of books that I don't recommend. Not a lot, but a number of them. I'm studying into Arianism and things. There's a book out there. Jesus was not a Trinitarian. That's all. This is a good book. There is a large group, and that's growing, teaches that Jesus was not a Trinitarian and neither should be. Sounds good, doesn't it? It also teaches that Christ was not pre-existent before Bethlehem. It also teaches that Jesus was not divine while on this earth. He lived a holy life. He was adopted by God, and after he went to heaven, God gave him his divinity. But they're non-Trinitarian. They believe in one God. And Jesus became a son of God after he went to heaven. We'll read this statement. Although the most helpless of God's creatures, I read that earlier, I'm going to read the second part of it. Maybe that's not the one. There it is. The two natures blended in Christ. And this is third selected messages, 131. Through being partakers of divine nature, we may stand pure and holy and undefiled. The Godhead was not made human, and the human was not defiled by the blending together of the two natures. Christ did not possess the same sinful, corrupt, fallen disloyalty. We have been disloyal, haven't we? Haven't we fallen? He did not have fallen disloyalty we possess, for then he would not be a perfect offering. Third volume of select messages, 131, paragraph 1. Third volume, right. I'm going to read another. Because a lot of people believe that when Jesus came to the earth, he laid aside his royal robe. That is correct. If he came as an angel, we could not behold him. If he came with his appearance of divinity, we could not. He could not have ministered to the people. He laid aside his looks. He laid aside his royalty. The Savior was deeply anxious. This is the desire of ages. The Savior was deeply anxious for his disciples to understand for what purpose his divinity was united with humanity. This book, Christ Was Not a Trinitarian, goes into Jesus could not be any less than 100% divine if he was divine. And there's no mathematical possibilities that he can be 100% divine and 100% human. It doesn't add up. Is God limited to our math?
No.
See what we happen, what happens when we get into logic? Laying aside his royal robe and kingly crown, Christ clothed his divinity with humanity, that human beings might be raised from their degradation and placed on vantage ground. Christ could not have come to this earth with the glory that he had in the heavenly courts. Sinful human beings could not have borne the sight. He veiled his divinity with the garb of humanity. But he did not part with his divinity.
That's right.
Is that clear? Did he read people's minds? Did he perform miracles through the power of God? I went through Desire of Ages, just skimming it. And I was only looking for the clear references. There's 28 clear references in Desire of Ages that Christ revealed his divinity while on this earth. There is 19 very clear, and I just read one of them, that he revealed his divinity and lived his divinity. He was totally divine when he was on this earth. So that's 47 clear statements just from Desire of Ages, and yet many of us believe that he was not divine. He's our divine Savior. The thing is, the hardest temptation for him was he could not use his divinity for himself in fighting with the temper. I got several references I want to close. I'm going to give you the reference for one. The longest one, Desire of Ages, 324. It's one of those back and forth ones. It's one of my favorite paragraphs in the whole of inspiration. Desire of Ages 324, about when the soul surrenders itself to Christ. Impregnable, if we neglect, we need to be vitally connected. Love is familiar with that. I'm going to read this short one because I'm way beyond my time. By Christ's perfect obedience, he has made it possible for every human being to obey God's commandments. When we submit ourselves to Christ, the heart is united with his heart. The will is merged with his will. The mind becomes one with his mind. The thoughts are brought into captivity to him. We live his life. This is what it means to be clothed with the garment of his righteousness. Then as the Lord looks upon us, he sees not the fig garment, not the nakedness and deformity of sin, but his own robe of righteousness, which is perfect obedience to the law of Jehovah. God help each one of us to keep our eyes fixed on Christ so that we can have this experience. This is our prayer. It's now. Our Father in heaven, we thank you for the warnings. We thank you for the opportunity of living in a time when we can help hasten your coming. Things are happening in the world at a massive, fast pace. The world is ready to destroy itself, and yet you're wanting a people to reflect your character. We thank you, Father, for the promises that we can claim, and we pray that we will live what we believe and what we've heard and what's been promised to us. All these things we ask in your dear Son's name. Amen.